Hello everyone, welcome to gatelectures.com. So we are recording, today we are recording UGC NET December 2013 paper 2, Electronic Science. And we are going to record this paper in two parts for better understanding. If you have any doubts, any suggestions, you can leave us in comments. And if you want access to our complete video lectures, complete courses, you can call or WhatsApp at 9821876104/02. So let us look at the first question. So they've given us a circuit in which there are this is an independent current source of 1 milliampere. This is a dependent current source of value. This is basically a dependent voltage source. Okay, this depends on this current I1 passing through this resistor 3.3 kilo ohm. And they're asking you the value of the current I1. So what am I doing is I just apply this here. Okay. I apply node analysis here, okay. Current that comes in has to go out, okay. That is the basic reason we are using. Now, 1 milliampere current is going in this branch. So, 1 milliampere current goes in this branch, right? And I1 current is going in this branch, which means that in this branch from this element 47 kilo ohm, 1 plus I1 current has to flow, right? Current flowing through this element is 1 plus I1. Now, current through this element is already I1. Again, see, if you apply nodal analysis here, I1 current comes from this branch, 20 milliampere came from this branch. So, total current passing through this resistor of 10 kilo ohm is going to be 20 plus I1. Now, what am I doing is, I am applying mesh analysis in this loop, okay? In this middle loop, I am applying mesh analysis. What do I do? I'm going to add total voltages across this loop and their sum is going to be 0. That is what mesh analysis say. So voltage across this element is going to be 47 into 1 plus I1, right? Then we've got a voltage element. So this is the voltage across this element is going to be minus 4I1. Okay. Voltage across this element is going to be 3.3 into I1. And again, voltage through this element is going to be 10 into 20 plus I1. So this should add up to 0. Okay, total voltage across this loop should be 0. Right, if you just try to solve this, what is it going to be? I'm just multiplying the respective terms. So I obtain something like this, okay. If you just simplify, you get 56.3 I1. Just add these two terms, okay, add all these terms. And you take this, so this becomes minus 247. Now they are asking you for the value of I1, which is going to be minus 247 upon 56.3. So this comes out to be approximately minus 4.096 milliampere, which is option B. So the correct answer to this question is going to be option B. Right. Now look at the next question. So they're asking you, this is just a theoretical question, they're asking you the formula for velocity of propagation in a rectangular metallic waveguide, right? So this formula is given by option A, velocity of propagation is given by, this is the frequency, angular frequency, omega is the angular frequency, mu is the constant, mu and epsilon, these two are constants, A and B are the dimensions of this rectangular waveguide, M and N are mode numbers. Okay, so the velocity of propagation Vp is given by this formula, option A. So the correct option is going to be A. This Vg is group velocity, okay. So phase velocity and group velocity are not related by this formula. Okay, phase velocity and angular frequency are related like this. So the correct answer is going to be option A. Move to the next question. The radiative and non-radiative lifetimes of minority carriers in active region of a double heterojunction LED. See, they're talking about double heterojunction LED. What happens in an LED is we are having a recombination region where charge carriers, minority and majority, both are going to recombine. And due to recombination of these carriers, energy is going to be released in form of light. That is how an LED works. Okay. Now, if you're having double heterojunction LED, what is going to happen? This is going to have two recombination regions, right? So they have given the radiative and non-radiative lifetimes of minority carriers and they're asking you about internal quantum efficiency. Now internal quantum efficiency of any LED is given by radiative recombination rate upon total recombination rate. This is radiative recombination rate, right? And this R is total recombination rate. total recombination rate. Now also you know that recombination rate, if we talk about, this is actually inversely proportional to carrier lifetime. Okay, more the carrier lifetime, less is the recombination rate. See why? Because as soon as the carrier recombines, less lifetime it is going to have, right? That is why these have inverse proportion. So I can also write this quantum efficiency as, this formula I can redefine as non-radiative lifetime upon total radiative lifetime. Using this relation, I can have this. Now, non-radiative lifetime was given as 60. This non-radiative lifetime was 100 nanoseconds. So, this is going to be 100 upon total lifetime is going to be 60 plus 100. Right? Now, if I have to find percentages, what do? I multiply this with 100. So, this is going to be 62.5%. So, the quantum efficiency of given heterojunction reality is going to be 62.5%, which is option B. So, the correct answer for this question is going to be option B. This is the formula that we are using. Okay, you can just remember this formula. Even if you get a question from LAD, normal LAD, then also you're going to use this formula only. Right. Now, come to the next question. In a P-type silicon sample, whole concentration is 2.25 into 10 to the power 15 per centimeter cube and intrinsic carrier concentration is 1.5 into 10 to the power 10 per centimeter cube. Now they are asking you for electron concentration. So we are going to use the mass action law here. What does mass action law say? Even if this is an extrinsic semiconductor, every semiconductor, be it extrinsic or intrinsic, it is going to follow mass action law. What does it say? Electron concentration into hole concentration, multiplication of electron concentration and hole concentration equals to square of intrinsic concentration. Okay, NP is equal to NI square. Now if you look at this question, this is a P-type sample and hole concentration, that is this P value, is given as 2.25 into 10 to the power 15, right? And intrinsic carry concentration, that is NI, is given as 1.5 into 10 to the power 10. Right, and they're asking about electron concentration, that is they're asking you about this N value. So if you just solve this, what do you obtain? It's going to be 2.25 into 10 to the power 20. These terms cancel out and N is going to be 10 to the power 5 per centimeter cube. So the electron concentration is going to be 10 to the power 5 per centimeter cube, which is option C. So the correct answer is going to be option C. See, one more thing that you can see here is, since this was a P-type sample, P-type sample means this is going to have more hole concentration. So look, if you just look at the hole concentration, it was 2.25 into 10 to the power 15 and electron concentration was 10 to the power 5, which means this is not an intrinsic semiconductor. Okay, in intrinsic semiconductor, hole concentration and electron concentration are going to be equal. But here holes are more, which means this is a P-type silicon sample. Right, that is what doping is. Okay, so move to the next question. A signal MF is equal to 5 sine 2 pi 100t frequency modulates a carrier. So this is the modulating signal and the resulting FM signal also they have given. Now they are asking you about approximate bandwidth. So bandwidth of an FM signal is given by this formula, 2 into delta F plus FM. This delta F is frequency deviation. This represents frequency deviation and this FM is modulation frequency. Modulation frequency. Now see, modulation frequency means frequency of the modulating signal, frequency of the input signal. Now this frequency, if you look here, frequency of the signal was 100. 2 pi ft is the basic how we represent signals. So if you just compare, this is going to be the FM, 100 hertz. Right, now we need to find out this frequency deviation. So frequency deviation we can find using the modulation index. We know that mu, which is the modulation index, is equal to delta F upon FM. Right, now how can you find this mu? See, mu is this term. This term represents mu or modulation index, KF, that you say. So value of mu in this equation is 15. We need to find delta F. And FM already we have seen it is 100. So which makes delta F is going to be 1500. Now if you try to find out bandwidth, it is going to be 2 into 1500 plus 100. Which comes out to be 3200 hertz or I can say 3.2 kilohertz. So bandwidth for this given FM signal is going to be 3.2 kilohertz, which is option C, right? So the answer comes out to be 3.2 kilohertz. See, this is the modulation index that we are using, okay? Why is this the modulation index? Because see, this signal was the modulating signal, okay? The coefficient of modulating signal KF, if you have studied, this represents the modulation index mu, right? So this 15 was our modulation index, right? So move to the next question. Look at question 6. So they're asking you about the octal equivalent of the given binary number. See, there are two approach to these questions. Firstly, what you can do is you just convert this binary number back to its decimal form, and then you convert basic conversion to octal. But that is going to take up a lot of time. So we can use a shortcut here. What is that? So first way is basically you convert binary to decimal and then decimal to octal, but this takes up lot of time. So I'd advise you not to follow this technique. You can follow this technique when you have unknown bases. Suppose you got base 7, base 6, then you cannot perform direct conversion. Then what you have to do is you have to convert given number to base 10, that is decimal, and from there you convert it to the required base. But when it is in powers of 2, that means if you have binary number octal hexadecimal, you can perform direct conversion. How? See, octal means base 8, which is 2 to the power 3. So what I can do is I can just form groups of 3 bits starting from the LSB of this number. See, given number is 1111001. So what do? Since this is third power of 2, what do? I form groups of 3 starting from LSB. Since this group formation is not possible, I append a zero. Appending a zero at MSB does not affect the number. So group of 3. Now I write their decimal equivalent. 001 is going to be 1, 111 is 7, and 011 is 3. So now this is going to be my required octal number, okay, which is option C. So the correct answer is going to be option C. So this is how you can convert this number directly to octal, okay? Suppose you had to convert it into hexadecimal directly. What would you do? Hexadecimal means base 16, which is 2 to the power 4. Now, since this is fourth power of 2, what would you do? You had to form groups of 4 bits starting from LSB, and then you can convert this binary number directly to hexadecimal number. Right. If you have some unknown bases which are not in powers of 2, what do? You convert the number first to decimal number, and from there you follow the standard procedure for conversion to unknown bases. Right. So move to the next question now. Right. So they have given a block diagram. This is a question from control system. Basically, they've given a block diagram and they're asking you to reduce this block diagram. Right. So they want you to find the transfer function. Now, see, this is an adder. They're using an adder here. Since G1 and G2 both are in the forward path, none of them is a feedback path. Both of them are forward path and are getting added. So I can just simplify this to one block, which would be G1 plus G2, right? And here we are having an adder. Since both of them were added, that is why I've placed a plus sign here. Right. Now, if you look at this one, this H is a feedback path. This is the feedback that we are using. And G3 is a forward path. Now, you know that whenever we are having such paths, what do we have? What transfer function we are having? We're going to have G3 upon 1 plus G3 into H. Right, when we are having an element in feedback path, this is how its transfer function simplifies. Right, now we do not need this adder also, okay, because we've simplified both the block diagrams. Now these two blocks are cascaded. Cascaded means placed one after the other. So what happens when I try to find out its equivalent? These two blocks are going to be multiplied with each other. Now if you look at the options, option D is going to represent their multiplication, G1 plus G2 into G3 upon 1 plus G3H, right? So if I had to simplify the block diagram, if I had to simplify it using one single block, it's going to be this one, option D. So the correct answer is going to be option B here, right? Now look at the next question. Gauge factor of a resistance via strain gauge is a measure of sensitivity, resolution, dynamic range, or variable inductance. See, what does gauge factor signify? Gauge factor is basically fractional change in resistance of this strain gauge per unit change in length, per unit fractional change in length or strain. So what happens in this strain gauge is, as you change its length or you change the strain that is given, there is going to be a change in resistance. So what does gauge factor measure? Gauge factor measures that for unit change in length or strain, how much change is going to occur in the resistance wire, right? So basically this measures sensitivity of the gauge, sensitivity of the gauge to change in length or strain, right? So gauge factor is actually a measure of sensitivity of the gauge. This is what formula that is used to measure the gauge factor, right? So this signifies sensitivity. Now what is resolution? Resolution is the minimum amount of change that can be measured by using an instrument. That is what resolution signifies, okay? And so there is no scene of inductance in this instrument, so all other options are insignificant. Correct answer is going to be option A. So the answer is going to be A. Right. Now look at the next question. In an LVDT, LVDT is linear variable differential transducer. So they are given, in an LVDT, two secondary wind map are connected in differential to obtain. See, in an LVDT, we are having two windings, and they are connected in differential. Now, why they are connected in differential? See, there are two types of connection. One is differential connection and the other one is integrating or sum connection. Now, we are using them in differential so that output voltage, which is phase sensitive, so their phase should be in conclusion whether displacement of the core took place from right to left or from left to right, to signify that we are connecting them in differential, and also in order to establish a null point or reference point. Fine. So if you just look at the options, correct options are going to be B and C, both B and C, which is option D, right? So the correct answer is going to be option D. See, there are two types of connection, but we're using differential connection so that a null point or reference point can be established, also to simplify phase calculations, right? So in an LVDT, we're using differential connection of the two secondary wind maps, right? Now look at the next question, question 10. Microprocessor is also known as CPU. What is CPU? So they're basically just asking you for the definition of CPU, which is central processing unit. So this is a very easy question. I don't think it needs any explanation. Answer is going to be option B. So the next question from C language, they've given you that if I is a variable, then what does I++ donates? So basically we're using this tag, this syntax for one increment in I, okay, incremented once. So the correct option is going to be option B. I++ means this I++ is actually incrementing I by one, okay, I+1 this is going to represent, right? So this is, we're using this in C language. They asked the question from there. Right, look at the next question now. For a SMF, following characteristics are given. What is this SMF? This SMF is actually single mode fiber. This is a question from optical fiber. So they are asking you about single mode fiber. There are two types of optical fiber that are being used, single mode and multi mode. Okay, this V number, this is actually normalized frequency parameter. V number, this is normalized frequency parameter. Right, and it determines number of modes that can pass through the optical fiber. This is a dimensionless number and determines number of modes. So for this single mode fiber, it's going to lie between 0 and 2.405, and this V number is going to be greater than 2.405 for multi-mode fiber. This is for multi-mode fibers. Right, for us SMF, that is single mode fiber, this characteristic is correct. Also, core radius is going to be less than 10 micrometer. Okay, this is going to be less than 10 micrometer for single mode fiber. For multi mode fiber, we're going to have a slightly bigger core radius, right? And attenuation is not of the order of 1 dB per kilometer, okay? We're going to face slightly different attenuation. So for the given SMF, characteristics that are true are 1 and 3. So 1 and 3 is the correct statement, and the answer is going to be option C for this question. Fine. Come to the next question now. So they are asking you about a directional coupler. What is a directional coupler? Actually, it is used to couple the powers of different ports. Okay, couple different ports power. Suppose this is a directional coupler, it's going to have four ports, right? Like this. Power from them is respectively going to be P1, P2, P3 and P4. Okay, now the power is applied at port 1, that means this is the input port, and output is taken from port 2, which means this is an output port. Now they have given you four statements, are asking about coupling coefficient and directivity. So see, coupling coefficient of a directional coupler, coupling coefficient relates the input ports only, because power is going to be coupled using these input ports only. So the coupling coefficient is going to be 10 log P1 upon P4, which means how much fraction of the power that has been input at port 4 reached port 1, P1 upon P4. So this is how coupling coefficient is given. And directivity. Directivity is going to relate output port with the input port. So directivity is going to be 10 log P4 by P3, which means how much power that was input at port 3 got back to port 4. Okay, this is what directivity is. So if you just look at the options, this first option is correct for coupling coefficient. This is how the formula for coupling coefficient is given, and directivity is given by this one, third. So according to the options, correct option is going to be option A. So answer to this question is going to be option A. For this directional coupler, you can just learn this formula. Okay, just try to remember these two formula, because they're going to be used again and again. Okay, if you attempt questions from this topic, right? So move to the next question. An AM demodulator can be implemented with. So basically, AM can be demodulated using a low pass filter. We're going to need a low pass filter. Before low pass filter, either you can just apply a diode. See, something like this. If you apply a diode, this is how a low pass filter is, right? So this capacitor is going to remove the unwanted RF. Okay, you are going to put the RF signal input here, and this capacitor is going to remove the unwanted RF, right? So in place of this diode, you can also use a linear multiplier, but you need a low pass filter after that. So if you just look at the options, we do not need band stop filter or high pass filter. Why? Because AM signal is always going to be a low pass signal. Okay, to reconstruct the original signal, we're going to use a LPF, low pass filter. So it can be implemented either by using linear multiplier and LPF, or a diode and LPF, right? So the correct option is going to be option C, that is either 1 or 3. So you can implement a demodulator using any of these. Fine, so come to the next question. NAND gate can also be represented by, see, this is how a NAND gate looks like. It is basically inversion of the AND gate. This is what the expression of NAND gate is, AB whole bar. And using De Morgan's law, you can write this AB whole bar as A bar plus B bar, which is actually, which can actually be represented as sum of A bar and B bar, right? This is going to give you A bar plus B bar. So NAND gate, NAND can be represented by AND invert, which is this expression. AND invert, this is how you can represent it using an AND invert, right? OR invert is not going to give you NAND gate, okay? This is going to give you NOR gate. Now this circuit, this gate is known as bubbled OR. Bubbled OR, why? Because we put bubbles or inversion towards the input and not at the output. So this is bubbled OR. Bubbled OR also represents NAND gate. So both of them are going to represent a NAND gate only, 1 and 3. So the correct option is going to be option D for this one, right? So the correct answer is going to be option D, right? So that's all for this part. You can watch the next part for the next set of questions. We're going to take this paper in parts so that you can concentrate better. If you have any suggestions, doubts, queries, you can leave us in comments. And anything else also you want to ask, you can ask. Any doubts you have, any suggestions you have. To get complete access, just call or WhatsApp on the number given in description, or email us at admin@gatelectures.com. Thank you for watching.